Good morning and welcome. Happy Father's Day. Today we celebrate the Mass for the 11th Sunday of ordinary time. Our procession this morning, sing praises to thee. Please rise.
Thank you. O God, strengthen those who hope in you. Graciously hear our pleas. And since without you mortal frailty can do nothing, grant us always the help of your grace, that in following your commands we may please you by our resolve and our deeds. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, the Israelites came to the desert of Sinai and pitched camp. While Israel was in camp here in front of the mountain, Moses went up to the mountain to God. Then the Lord called to him and said, "Thus shall you say to the house of Jacob, tell the Israelites, you have seen for yourselves how I treated the Egyptians, and how I bore you up an eagle of wings and brought you here to myself. Therefore, if you hearken to my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my special possession, dear to me than all other people, though all the earth is mine. You shall be me, a kingdom of priests, a holy nation." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
said to his disciples, "The harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. So ask the master of the harvest to send out laborers for his harvest." And he summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to drive them out and to cure every disease and every illness. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first Simon, son of Peter, and his brother Andrew; James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus; Simon from Cana; Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Jesus sent out these 12 after instructing them thus: "Do not go into pagan territory or enter a Samaritan town, but rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, make this proclamation: the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, drive out demons. Without cost you have received, without cost you are to give." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
There are many complicated things in this world, but I think there is nothing more complicated than the human heart. And the human heart is difficult to understand. We never really understand the heart of another person unless he or she chooses to open it up to us. We should never presume we know another person's thoughts or another person's motives, even if we're very close to that person. Because we don't. We're not mind readers. We know what is in another person's heart when it is shared with us. We really don't even fully understand our own hearts. Quite often, the problems in this world, I believe, are because we live up here and we're cut off from our hearts. We don't understand what's going on in our hearts. And so we just rely solely upon our minds and the things we think of from moment to moment. There was one time when I was in seminary, I was having a very hard time. I was seriously thinking about leaving. And I went to Mass one morning, it was during Lent, and the first reading was from Jeremiah. And I was amazed. Maybe I'd heard this before, I didn't even remember. But it certainly hit me that day. I went back to my room and I looked it up, and I committed it to memory. "More torturous than all else is the human heart, beyond remedy. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, alone explore the mind and test the heart." What a wonderful passage to sit with. It's very reassuring to know that whatever is going on in our hearts, no matter what kind of struggle, no matter how complicated, God knows our hearts. He gets it. He understands what it means to have a heart, because God himself, in the person of Jesus, had a heart. And so we don't ever have to be afraid to open our hearts up fully to God, because he knows our hearts anyway. He created our hearts. I don't know about you, but sometimes I have a lot of questions about the human heart. Most of us have, or try to have, an optimistic view of humanity. We want to believe that somehow humanity is getting better, that we're making progress. We try to assign the best motives possible. But during some of the most optimistic moments in our history, when there was real progress in medicine and education and human rights, right in the middle of those wonderful moments, we see evil spring up. Germany, immediately prior to Hitler, was a democracy. It was one of the cultural centers of the world. Some of the greatest musicians and artists and philosophers, and in the 1920s, filmmakers came out of Germany. If you've ever watched some of the old German films prior to the rise of Hitler, they're wonderful. Those filmmakers understood what it meant to be human. They had some wonderful values communicated in those films. And yet we see Nazi Germany arise. Here in the U.S. at the same time, we were making progress in universal education, advances in technology. But we had strict segregation in many states and opposition to anti-lynching laws. Yesterday, down at the old cathedral, we had the procession of St. John for Malafa, which means great disaster, remembers the millions and millions of Africans kidnapped from Africa and brought to this part of the world
in these slave ships, stacked like sardines. And Bishop Troy, excuse me, Bishop Perry, he came down from Chicago and gave us a talk yesterday. It was so difficult to listen to. And it went on for about 20, 25 minutes. It was painful to listen to because he went into very great detail, everything connected to the international slave trade and what the different tribes and communities were like in Africa, what it was like on the ships, how they were treated when they were brought to the different Caribbean islands, you know, and Cartagena and the United States at that time, the colonies. Painful to listen to. The human heart is beautiful, and it's made in God's image, and yet it is so prone to becoming twisted and disturbed. Some people's hearts get so disturbed, God alone understands. And perhaps even in our own individual hearts, there may be thoughts or feelings that we aren't proud of. And again, we don't have to be afraid to allow God to see that, because he knows us inside and out. Again, he created those hearts. In today's gospel, we have proof that Jesus has a heart, because the gospel opens with the words, at the sight of the crowds, Jesus' heart was moved with pity for them. They were like sheep without a shepherd. Now, there are other passages in the New Testament we're all familiar with that refer to Jesus' heart. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he says to his disciples, my heart is filled with sorrow. Stay up with me. Now, in another passage, he weeps at the death of Lazarus. Now, in another passage, he looks with love upon the rich young man who asks, what does it take to be saved? Jesus had a heart. Because of his union with the Father and the Holy Spirit, God has a heart. That's why 2 days ago, as a church, we're celebrating the solemnity of the Sacred Heart. And in fact, the entire month of June is dedicated to the Sacred Heart. Now, granted, some aspects of Sacred Heart devotion seem to come from an earlier age. You know, but one of the questions I asked in today's bulletin article, and something that I used to wonder about, why are so many parishes and schools and religious orders and Catholic institutions named after the Sacred Heart? And I think it's because we've sometimes been given harmful images of God as a tyrannical God, someone who is always on the verge of punishing humanity because he sees what's in our hearts. God wants to punish us. You know, we only get into heaven by the technicality of being saved by Jesus. God wants to strike us down. And even on the head level, even up here, we reject that. That image was given to us as kids or as young adults, be it in the Catholic Church, by listening to some televangelist, wherever we may receive that harmful image of God, even if we reject it here, sometimes it sinks in here. And we struggle with that image of God as a traffic cop who's always keeping careful watch of our sins. That image not only works itself into individual hearts, but I also believe when we look at our history, it worked its way into the history of our nation. Because Calvinistic Christianity, which had a very pessimistic view of the human heart and somewhat pessimistic view of God, played a major role in the foundation of the American colonies. And fundamentalist Christianity has always been a strong undercurrent in our society. And it is never too far away from politics, even today, as we see in so many of the national debates. So that image of the Sacred Heart has always been a counterbalance to the harmful images of God we may have absorbed at some point in our thinking. In today's gospel, Jesus gives tremendous power to his disciples to cure the sick, cleanse lepers, raise the dead, drive out demons. It sounds as if he's giving them magical powers, that he's turning them into some kind of first century group of superheroes. But it wasn't magic. What Jesus was giving them was the power of the heart, the power to love, to look upon those who are sick or suffering or mourning the loss of a loved one, to look at them with compassion and a desire to help. He's asking us to allow our hearts to be shaped like his, to have space for other people, including those who are hurting, even those who we might consider our enemies. Without Jesus, our hearts are so small, there isn't much room for anything but ourselves and those who meet our own emotional needs. But with the heart of Jesus, our hearts expand and our ability to love expands, and we can risk loving others because we've taken the risk of accepting the fact that God loves us passionately and unconditionally. We've taken the risk of rejecting harmful images of God. We've accepted that God loves us at our worst and our most sinful moments as much as he does at our best. Do we believe that? God loves us at our worst moments as much as he does at our best. His only desire is that we turn to him and follow him, because that's the only way to be truly happy. And so as we continue with this liturgy, we pray that our own hearts can learn to beat in unison with the heart of God, with the heart of Jesus, that we can really transform our hearts to his. May we share with him that absolute trust in God. And through Jesus, may we claim the power Jesus speaks of in today's gospel, the power to love unconditionally, which is the greatest power a Christian can have. Speaking of conforming our hearts to Jesus, that's something that begins in baptism. Because when we're baptized, we put on Christ, and we make the decision to make our hearts be like Jesus' heart. And so today, Trinity is going to be baptized, and she's also going to make her first communion and receive the sacrament of confirmation. It is such a big step in a person's life to give ourselves entirely to God. That's what we do when we're baptized. And so, Trinity, I invite you, your sponsor, your family, to please join me over here.
So, my brothers and sisters, let us pray for our sister who has asked for Christ's sacraments, and let us pray also for ourselves, that we may draw nearer to Christ in faith and repentance, and to walk untiringly in newness of life. And so that the Lord may kindle in all of us a spirit of true repentance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we who have died to sin and been saved by Christ through baptism may be living proof of his grace, we pray to the Lord. That by the power of the Holy Spirit, all may be cleansed from sin and guided along the path of holiness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord.
And for all the family and friends of Trinity, that God will bless them and keep them safe, we pray to the Lord.
Lord.
And that the entire world, for which the Father gave his beloved Son, may believe in his love and turn to him, we pray to the Lord. So, Father of mercies, you sent your only Son to rescue us from the slavery of sin and to give us true freedom as your children. We pray for Trinity, that she has faced the temptations of this world and has been tested by the cunning of Satan. Now she acknowledges her sinfulness and professes her faith. By the passion and resurrection of your Son, deliver her from the powers of darkness and strengthen her through the grace of Christ, that she may journey through life shielded by your unfailing care. We ask this Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Christ our Savior strengthen you with his power, for he is Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
And dear friends, let us pray for our sister to Almighty God, that he may bless her with light and strength as she receives the sacraments of baptism and confirmation. May God give her the new life of the Holy Spirit, whom we are about to call down upon this water. So, Father, you give us grace through sacramental signs, which tell us of the wonders of your unseen power. In baptism, we use your gift of water, which you have made a rich symbol of the grace you give us in the sacrament. At the very dawn of creation, your Spirit breathed on the waters, making them the wellspring of holiness. The waters of the great flood, you made a sign of the waters of baptism that make an end of sin and a new beginning of goodness. Through the waters of the Red Sea, you led Israel out of slavery to be an image of God's holy people, set free from sin by baptism. In the waters of the Jordan, your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Your Son willed that water and blood should flow from his side as he hung upon the cross. After his resurrection, he told his disciples, go out and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Father, look now with love upon your church, and seal for it the fountain of baptism. By the power of the Holy Spirit, give this water the grace of your Son, so that in the sacrament of baptism, all those whom you have created in your likeness may be cleansed from sin and rise to a new birth of innocence by water and the Holy Spirit. We ask you, Father, with your Son, to send the Holy Spirit upon the waters of this font. May all who are buried here with Christ in the death and baptism rise also with him to newness of life. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Trinity, one thing you've probably seen us do at different times is to renew our baptismal promises. So at this moment, you will make our baptismal promises, and we will all renew ours with you. And so the response will be, I do. Do you reject sin so as to live in the freedom of God's children?
I do.
Do you reject the glamour of evil and refuse to be mastered by sin?
I do.
Do you reject Satan, father of sin and prince of darkness?
I do.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified, died, and was buried, rose from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
This is our faith, and this is the faith of the Church. We are proud to profess it through Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
And Trinity, are you ready to be baptized into the faith that we have just professed with you? So please place your head on the font. Trinity, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Symbolizes the fact that you have been clothed in Christ. And so receive this baptismal garment and bring it unstained to the judgment seat of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that you may have everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
And now we light the candle off of the baptismal candle, which we bless at Easter. Trinity, receive the light of Christ. You have been enlightened by Christ. Walk always as a child of the light, and keep the flame of faith alive in your heart. When the Lord Jesus comes, may you go out to meet him with all the saints in the heavenly kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
And so you can give your candle to your godmother. And Trinity, born again by Christ in baptism, you have become a member of Christ and of his priestly people. Now you are to share in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit among us, the Spirit sent by the Lord upon his apostles at Pentecost, and given by them and their successors to the baptized. God's Holy Spirit will assist you in living the Christian life and to be a good Christian. And so, my dear friends, let us pray to God our Father that he will pour out the Holy Spirit upon our newly baptized sister to strengthen her with his gifts and anoint her to be more like Christ, the Son of God. All-powerful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by water and the Holy Spirit, you freed your Son from sin and gave him new life. Send your Holy Spirit upon her to be his helper and her helper and guide. Give her the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of right judgment and courage, the spirit of knowledge and reverence. Fill her with the spirit of wonder and awe in your presence. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
To sponsor, please place your right hand on Trinity's shoulder. Trinity, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
And peace be with you.
With your spirit.
Okay, Trinity. We didn't practice beforehand. Trinity, you have now been baptized into the body of Christ and become our sister in Christ. You have been sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit through confirmation, and the gifts of the Spirit will continue to develop in you as you move through life as a daughter of God and as a follower of Jesus. In a few minutes, you will deepen your union with Christ and with us through the reception of Holy Eucharist. And so may God bless you and keep you always close to his heart. And as you take your place back among the people of God, let's all acknowledge our joy with Trinity. Congratulations. God of all creation, through ministry receive the wine we offer. Fruit of the vine and fruit of the hands, become our spiritual drink.
Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and
filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, under his constant intercession in your presence, may your life and faith in God. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. And please to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Mitchell, our bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people who have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you, and your compassionate merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you with their passing through this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Hold the Lamb of God.
Behold, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. As this reception of your Holy Communion, O Lord, foreshadows the union of the faithful in you, so may it bring about unity in your church. Through Christ our Lord. Could you please be seated for a moment?
Just a few announcements. First of all, if you are a money counter, earlier this week I sent out an email about 3 days ago with the sign-up genius. Now I believe two people have responded. But if you are a money counter, we really need folks to sign up for the next 3 months. I'm scheduling through the end of September. And also there's a note when I sent out to you that, you know, August 1st, obviously going to become part of a new parish. And so Father Mitch might change that somewhat, but I wanted to at least try to give him a couple of months to get ready to whatever changes he wants to make. And so I believe our people here would be counting the money after the second Mass of the day, the last Mass of the day. The Mass would be later in the morning here. So anyway, please take a look at that. And if you need me to resend an email to you, let me know. As you saw in the petitions, and perhaps you saw in the news, 10 young people were shot in St. Louis last night, downtown, it was 14th in Washington. One person has died at last count, and perhaps others will. But obviously, it's just a terrible situation. And we are called to work to correct gun violence, and that means legislation. That also means helping young people to make good choices. Functions on so many different levels. And so July 29th at the Gali Center, Archdiocese headquarters, there is an all-day summit on gun violence. And if you go to our parish website, you can see the information on that. I actually put it on there a couple of weeks ago. But take a look at that and consider that last Saturday in July, July 29th, signing up and attending that workshop. All things new update. Last week I mentioned that we're working out details with the three parishes and Father Mitch, just looking at various things that need to be considered. I just want to reiterate, the first Sunday of August, we will all be over at Most Holy Trinity for their night, for the night to be Mass. The following Sunday, the second Sunday of August, we will all be here for Unity Mass. After that, every Sunday, there will be two Masses. One Mass, the earlier Mass, will be over at Most Holy Trinity site. The second Mass will be here, and then weekday Masses and Holy Day Masses will be over at St. Nicholas. And so we're trying to have Mass at all three sites right now. But a couple of things that go with that that's very important, folks have already been asking that. If you give online giving to Saints Teresa and Bridget, don't change anything come August 1st. Just continue to give to Saints Teresa and Bridget Church through online giving. If you write a check, please do not write Parish of Most Holy Trinity, St. Nicholas, and St. Teresa and Bridget. If you fit that in the register, write it out to St. Teresa and Bridget. Because even if canonically our name changes, legally everything stays the same for a while under civil law. And so we wouldn't be able to cash a check like that. At some point in the fall, you'll be given more instructions on that. Also, Maintenance Committee has been very busy recently. A few weeks ago, we asked for some help. If you're free on Saturday mornings, please give some help. The past few days, they've been emptying out the chips building, arranging for different charities to pick up dental equipment and supplies, medical equipment. And so, again, especially if you're younger, physically fit, you might give Tom Nolan a call. He's head of maintenance committee, or Ron Johnson, who's head of maintenance, to see if you can help with all of the things, including the armor. Okay, and then following Mass today, there's the Father's Day breakfast downstairs from the Ladies' Guild. But two things we do before that. And so first of all, we bless our fathers. So if you are a father or a father figure to someone, we play that role, please stand. And the rest of us, let's extend our hands and bless them. God our Father, in your wisdom and love, you have created us and called us your own. Bless all the fathers here present, they may be strengthened by you. Bless those who have died, that they may rest in your peace. Fill them in faith and love. In moments of joy, rejoice with them.
times of struggle, give them your courage and perseverance. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor and appreciate them always with a spirit of profound respect. May the example and prayer of St. Joseph inspire them to live their vocation with courage. Grant this to Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy Father's Day. Weeks ago, we were asking for the names of the graduates, so we're going to present some awards to the graduates.
Lord,